Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10.05 p.m. Central Time on the 26th of December, 2017. Day after Christmas here in the States. So I hope you guys are all doing well. If you celebrated the holiday, back to the work week. And here we are on the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we do daily recaps of seismic events, and we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecast for new areas to watch for movement to strike around the planet. And I'm going to turn on a display capture here, because bringing that up just really quick, here on my back end on YouTube, I just want to show you guys, we did an unboxing yesterday on December 25th. It was great. It was 3 hours long, really fun, opening packages and letters from people from around the world, fan mail, and YouTube has now hit my video is not advertiser friendly. It's under attack. And then my forecast from yesterday, last night at 10 p.m., came under serious attack today. One out of six people hate the video or more, and it's going down, down, down. 11,000 people have seen it, 100 thumbs down, and horrible, horrible comments. I'm not even deleting them. I'm leaving them up so you guys can see it. It's just insane what's going on. So my videos are under attack. Not here to complain, just letting you know. I mean, I shouldn't have to ask you to like my videos, you know, if you're a subscriber of mine. Anyways, big attack on the forecast, whatever. We are here to talk about the earthquakes that struck since last night. So what happened since last night? Two new sets of deep quakes. Where? Well, no other than on our letter D's, right in the middle of our letter D here. You see this? 4.4 measuring in at 568 kilometers deep. Next to Tonga, over to the west, we have it right on our letter D as well, 4.6 to 4.7. Again, these are different earthquakes, but the 4.6 is the deep earthquake. That's coming in at about 537 kilometers deep. Not about, that is what it's measured at, 537. So on one side, 500, on the other side, 500. Something's going on down below the plate in an area called the asthenosphere. And that's just a complex geologist word for the area down below the plate where the magma resides. The semi-melted magma, not as fluid-like as more down in the mantle, which is much hotter. As we go across the West Pacific, going up towards Japan, the only earthquake to strike today in the Northwest Pacific, near 5.0, downgraded to 4.6. Look where it struck. Look at this, guys. This is pretty interesting. Struck between our previous sets of eruptions. So if you go back a day and a half, there were a series of eruptions down at Sakurajima and up here at the south tip or at central Kamchatka, Russia. Halfway point comes in here, but we're looking for new activity. If you guys haven't watched the forecast, please go watch the forecast. We're looking for new activity, possibly into the mid-range 5, maybe even a little bit larger, striking up near Japan. Over to the west, look what happened today across Asia, going into the Middle East and into Europe. First of all, new 4.0 activity popped up where? Outskirts of Tehran again. 4.2, 4.0, added together equals about a 4.3. That's on the north plate boundary. Okay, guys, so we had warned up here, and we warned for up to a 5, and we get a 4.3. That's within the realm of acceptability. It's on the northern arrow, right on the tip of the arrow, so we're going to count that. And it came from the earthquakes a day ago that we talked about over here in India, North India, Pakistan, Afghanistan border region. So 5's worth of energy struck over here. It pushed to the west and caused a 4.3's worth of energy to be released. If you add in the other 4.8 and 4.1, guess what that equals? Right on at 5.0. So if you go 4.2 plus 4.0, that's 4.3. Add in a 4.8, and we're equaling about a 4.93, right? Then add in the 4.1, and we're right at 5.0. Over to the west, look what happened in Europe today. Up in Poland, a new round of activity, a new 4.0 after yesterday's 4.8. And yesterday's 3.3 over in Romania last night. Today, new swarm breaking out between Sicily, Campobasso, all the way up into Norcia. That's right, guys, Norcia, Campobasso, and Sicily. That's all today. We're looking for Iceland to get hit in the next few days. By the way, off the pressure coming out of Europe. Over all the way across the Atlantic, going into the United States, Central America, South America. Quickly take a look at the screen here, guys. Central America, Mexico, a little less than where we were yesterday. Yesterday, it was a pretty intense increase. But I think in Mexico, the highest we're going is near 6 at the most. Next to each volcano, we're seeing new activity. And Costa Rica starting to swarm. Which means, most likely, Turrialba will either be on the list or Poes volcano. So Poes or Turrialba, I don't forecast for those. Any volcanic eruptions, I do not forecast for. But that's what we're going to look for. Because that's what usually happens before an eruption, some kind of swarm. As we look in South America last night, those arrows that we talked about, both tips were hit, right? And the middle point was hit last night. Today, nothing. So really, over the last day, I mean, I would say this was this morning. Technically, these were this morning. But over the rest of the day, really not much activity down in South America at all. And we'll get into that in a second because these deep earthquakes are going to be causing shallower, larger earthquakes in the next few days. Let me get a sip of my apple cider. Ooh, okay. It's still a little hot. So as we go down into New Zealand and then back across over to South America, these deep earthquakes are going to be causing shallower, larger movement to the west, to the east, and to the south. So every time we see new deep earthquakes here, we have to warn the people down in New Zealand at the central plate boundary, where the red line goes across between the North and South Island. So it's on a regular basis at this point. When deep earthquakes strike to your north, 4.0s, we see 4.0s strike on the plate boundary, usually within the same magnitude. Also, we see pressure transfer up and cause shallower, larger activity to the west and to the east. So to the west is where we're going to look for 1 to 2 magnitudes larger, and I'm starting to think we're going to go a full 2 magnitudes larger. So 2 magnitudes larger puts us up in the 6 range, mid-range 6, striking between these two deep sets of quakes. Where does that put us? Two deep sets of quakes right here, both happening 500 kilometers or more down below the plate, leveraging up on the middle point, the fulcrum point, brings us into Solomon Islands, Solomon Sea, new 6.5, developing right now to strike within the next 72 hours or less from this point. Okay? That's going to translate over to South America. So if we're going to see a larger earthquake strike here, that means there's going to be an increase in South America, but we already talked about this in the forecast. It's going to be going up into the mid-range 5 level at the most. Central America, we're watching, waiting, bated breath, watching Mexico to see if there's an increase that happens over the next few days, magnitude-wise. If these come up into the 5s, if we graduate out of 4s and go into 5s, like a swarm of 5s hit, then we will readdress this, okay? I told you guys that in the forecast. Now, for the United States, look what happened today and just in the past few, last hour, I suppose. A new 3.0 earthquake struck in the Midwest on top of a 2.6. But really, you'll see they downgraded this to 2.9. Well, if you add the 2.9 and 2.6 together, that equals 3.0 right on the money. Also, a 2.7, same-sized earthquake, struck over to the east. That's right, at North Carolina and Tennessee's border on the eastern edge of the North American Craton. Now, we've talked about this at length. We issued warnings for central western Oklahoma at the Kansas border a day and a half ago. Why did we issue warnings for that? The 3.0 right here that struck at the northwest edge, if I could say it. Northwest edge got hit. Now a new 3 or near 3 strikes at the pumping operations. And I'd like to show you these pumping operations, especially for new viewers who might not understand. We're talking about thousands of points where humans have drilled into the earth, and that's created perforations or weak spots on the edge of the craton. You know what? Before I go any further on that, let me just quickly show you the craton diagram. There we go. Take a look at the craton diagram. And make note of the orange versus purple. I put the black arrows on there to let you know which way pressure flows, but you can find this diagram almost anywhere at this point. And that's just the overall way pressure flows. Now look at our arrows on the globe where the earthquakes are marked, and you'll see our 2.7 is over on the eastern edge of the craton, and then Oklahoma smack dab right in the middle, and then we have Texas cut off on earthquake 3D. So the two graphics technically are slightly different. And when we look at the North American craton this way, you'll understand. Pressure transfers from the west coast of the United States, and then it hits the western edge of the craton up here near Montana, Wyoming, Yellowstone. Yellowstone is right here. Here's Lake Yellowstone, for instance. Pushes down to the east-southeast. Now, you have to understand, it's not the 3.0 that's pushing down to the east-southeast. It's this greater seismic pressure. The seismic pressure is different than the earthquakes. The seismic pressure causes the earthquakes. So when you see a 3 up to the west-northwest, then you see a 3 at the fracking operations, then you see a 2.7 over to the east, North America has absorbed 0.3 off of that 3 that originally pushed. But that 3 that originally pushed, again, I told you, that's not the actual push. It's the seismic pressure that caused the 3. It's like the seismic pressure is the overall force leaving behind its fingerprints along the way as it travels along this route that it takes. And the route that it takes, route, whatever you want to say that, is following the interior edge of the craton. I'm going to turn on our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed. This will show us all the smaller microquakes. And longtime viewers, this is going to stand out to you already. New viewers, let me quickly explain. Where you see stacks of earthquakes, these are what are called earthquake swarms, where a single location is experiencing multiple events at once over the course of a few hours. So obviously, Southern California has now clustered itself out, segregated itself out across the eastern portion of LA, I guess that's east of the LA basin, and northeast of San Diego. Where does that take us? That takes us into a location where they have confirmed, the professionals have confirmed, there's a slow slip of North America passing side by side with the Pacific plate. So this big swarm here is letting us know the plate is moving. And the slow slip, we should call it a faster slow slip, because it's actually moving faster with all of these events that have picked up in number and picked up in frequency, so the number of events tapped on top of each other, and the power, the magnitude have increased. So we're talking about the number of earthquakes and the power of the earthquakes increasing simultaneously. Coming up out of zeros, going to ones, coming up out of ones and going to twos, and spreading out across the San Andreas Fault, which is located directly along the plate boundary. The plate boundary is the San Andreas. But there's a split that happens north of LA. One portion of the San Andreas goes up to the west-northwest. The Garlock Fault connects over to the east and then goes up along California-Nevada's border. And when we get up to there at the border with California, we have another swarm. This is happening at a place called Mammoth Mountain. So Mammoth Mountain is a ski resort. There's also another swarm simultaneously across the border. And let me show you what's at this location. It's called Aurora Crater, also Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. Now, it's not a mud volcano at the location. It's actually a pretty impressive volcano. Let me show it to you. Here we go. So here is Aurora Crater right here. Aurora Crater. Let me zoom in on this. You can still see the black basalt, and we still have some obsidian and lava flow there. And then over to the west, right across here, is Mud Springs Volcanic Butte, which rises about 300 feet off the desert floor and is formed by this ancient cinder here that formed a sill and flowed this all out over the desert. Now, right next to this is Mono Lake Supervolcano, and it's about half the size of Yellowstone, located right here. So I'll mark that. You guys are welcome to pause this and read it if you want to. We're not worried about an eruption, so don't go flying off the handle here. It's just a swarm letting us know pressure is going down the fault zone, up the fault zone, and along the plate boundary. Now, this location, I showed you guys last night, we went and looked it up just to make sure there was either something there, if there was going to be a volcano there or not. Well, there was nothing there. There's solely a fault zone there, and it's connected with the plate boundary on the interior. So what I'm getting at here is this swarm, I'll mark it in blue, this swarm, going down to the south, we skip over Coso Valley, where there's just a small micro swarm, and then we pick up in Southern California. Now, you got to remember all this. Remember all these locations that I'm showing you now. We get up to Northern California, and we have a new little breakout that's happening at geysers, which is actually good news to see activity return to geysers, California. You want to see activity at geysers. When it stops, that's where we start to get a little worried. And it stopped yesterday completely. So today it's returned. So keep track of where all these swarms are in California and at the California-Nevada border. And now I'm going to show you a website provided by the University of Washington State. This will show us the tremors, the microquakes up in northern portion of the United States, northwestern, so Washington, Oregon, Northern California. We're going to look at 24 hours and 48 hours worth of these microquakes, which are not shown here. So the USGS is not reporting to us the microquakes out of Northern California, Oregon, Washington, or if they are, they're very limited. We have to come to this website to see the actual tremors that are happening, the small zeros and small, very small microquakes. 24 hours, look. Notice anything, guys? If you're a longtime viewer, you've seen this now spread out in a line going north and south from the California border, now extending up towards Eugene. And further to the north, a secondary pocket at Portland, between Salem and Portland, but pretty much just to the west of Portland at this point. Now, this is the last 24 hours. A few small clusters down to the south, and then their network stops coverage pretty much right at Redding and at Eureka. That's where we pick up with all of these that I just showed you down in California. That's why I told you to remember each location. So down in Southern California, California at the Central California border, and then going up to this swarm location south of Lake Tahoe and over to geysers, California. Remember those? And now put those in your mind's eye on this map. And imagine a bunch of red dots down here at Southern California, a bunch of red dots Central California, a bunch of red dots near Lake Tahoe, and a bunch of red dots over here to the west. And what does that do? That connects an area that goes from Southern California up to the east and then back over to the west. And the whole plate, now look at 48 hours. This is a big increase from where we were. And I'm not exaggerating this. People told me last year that just one cluster indicated a part of a slow slip, including the professionals. They all talked about just one cluster up here at the Olympic Peninsula going, and they're like, ah, plate slow slipping. Now we have a whole state and a half, two states. And if you incorporate in all the earthquakes down here, all of California, all of Oregon, stopping at the Washington border at this point. And that's actually a slight change. Yesterday, there were some around Seattle. And if that stopped up to the north, we're going to look up to the north, and I've already issued the warning up to the north for this week, up here north of Vancouver Island, south of Graham Island, I guess, Queen Charlotte and Haida Gwaii, south of there, northwest of Vancouver Island is where I am watching. But something is currently pushing all of North America along the coast. What is that? Let's go show you on Google Earth. Out here, we have a bunch of red triangles. These are all Smithsonian place marks. I'll turn all this gobbledygook off so we can just see the fault zones themselves and the plate boundary fracture zones. This is the famous Juan de Fuca. And it goes down to the south and meets with the Mendocino Ridge, Gorda Escarpment, over to the west. Hopefully you can read this. And this is one of the most famous fracture zones in the world where people are looking for a mega quake to strike. And a mega quake is something above the mid 8, 9.0 level. We're talking about, you know, the largest earthquakes in the world are sought after in this location. They're studied, they're looked for. People have talked about this. They've issued documentaries about it. Talking about, even the New Yorker wrote that irresponsible article last year talking about how there's going to be a mega quake up here destroying everything west of I-5. Well, I-5 goes right along through here. There it is. C-5. All right, that yellow line going north and south. They said everything west of I-5 would be destroyed in the next large coming mega quake. They don't give you a time frame for it, except for generalities going into decades, which is, again, not good for an article that's telling you that you're going to be destroyed. You need to have a better idea of what time frame to issue that large mega quake warning. I can tell you that there haven't been any earthquakes of any noteworthy size reported out here in a long time. We can say certainly weeks, but we can even extend that to months where we haven't seen anything above a 5.0 earthquake struck. And that's even pushing it. We'd probably even say 4.5. They haven't reported. And we can go back and back and back where this is normally shown, fours and fives over years. So now radio silence coming out of the northwest means there could be a potential of a building megaquake due to this. Because all of California, 1,300 miles, we've already measured it, from just to the south tip of Victoria at Vancouver Island, going across all of the coast of Washington, all of the coast of Oregon, and all of California. That's about 1,300 miles across, all slow slipping at once. And it's not my take on it that slow slips cause large earthquakes. You can go consult the University of California Riverside article that's talking about Anzac Gap and the slow slip and how that leads to large earthquake activity when the slow slip finally starts to stop. So when this comes to a jerking halt, that's when we see activity strike right off the coast. Because this is all happening, like I said, on land. It's happening on land. We're seeing movement here all the way up the coast. So something out here is pushing it. And there's only one thing out here that could be pushing it, and it's the spot that hasn't seen one single earthquake, not even a 0.0, reported out here. And they are capable of reporting ones and zeros out here. We've seen it before, you know, over the past several months, many months ago, they were reporting small earthquakes out here. And it's not that the network's not covering out there. They still have the capability of reporting them. There just aren't any, which is troubling for me when I see an area that's seismically prone going completely silent. And it made me even question, still does, whether or not they're hiding earthquakes out there, because that's how quiet it's been. Suspiciously quiet. And I'm looking for activity to strike to the west-northwest. The only other activity we need to talk about today was the 3.0 that struck on the creeping section of the San Andreas. Where did that come from? Well, we have to go back a couple days, and let me quickly show that to you. Go back in our feed, and we go back up here to the west-northwest. We had two different things happen. Threes came down across Port Hardy, Canada, and coming out of Alaska, and that weird five that they removed and then put back on and then removed and then put back on is now back on. So did it hit? Did it not hit? Well, only time will tell. This is from the 22nd, so this is from 4 days ago. It could very well be that most of that energy went over across Nunavut. And it could very well be that this 5.0 earthquake up here at the North Pole that struck the next day, this struck on the 22nd, this struck on the 23rd. Well, we called it the North Pole earthquake for a reason. It could very well be that all of the energy, or most of it, since it struck north of our red arrow, which is more rare. Guys, normally the earthquakes strike here, where there's a split between all three. This one struck up here, it's pretty obvious, north of the red arrow, which means, boom, look what happened. It only lost a 0.1 off the 5, and it struck the next day. All in all, I'm going to have to tell you, pressure transfers from the west coast and goes to the east coast. Look at the last several days' worth of quakes, and this will tell you the tale of pressure pushing. So we saw a push up to the west-northwest. There's no doubt about that. Then the leftovers spilled over to the east following the edge of the craton. And here we are. The color coding tells us the most recent earthquakes. So in a progression going over to the east, pretty much all the same sized earthquakes. What caused that? A push from the west coast. Okay. Now, that is just a kind of a recap in a nutshell of what's happened in the U.S. and around the planet over the last 24 hours. This is since last night, guys. This isn't like me going on some long thing about all the earthquakes this past week. This is today only. It took 30 minutes of explanation to give you the earthquakes across the planet and the smaller earthquakes in the U.S. That should let you know something. You know what? Hold on. New 5.0 earthquake struck while I was talking here in the Kuril Islands. Check it out. Look at the halfway fulcrum point that's just been checked off the list between our volcanoes and our earthquake. So earthquake here, volcanoes here, erupting where Chevelouche returned on the list yesterday. Well, now halfway point filled in with a 5 in the Kuril Islands. Color coding tells the tale. Oh, it's not even up for debate. The halfway fulcrum point between this 4.6 and the letter V brings us right to here, where the 5.0 earthquake resides, right here. So we come up and around, brings us, and up and around, it brings us. You got to, again, take this little notch into account where the volcano exists, right where they meet. And that's the halfway. Just hit, as I was talking. All right, that's hit. Well, let's just make sure on that. How long ago did it hit? They just populated it, but they just upgraded it to 5.2. It struck at 4:11 UTC, so 20 minutes ago it struck. Okay, well, there we go. We're going back up. We are going back up. It's official now. We're coming out of fours and going into fives. We went a whole day with fours, right? All day with fours in the West Pacific, now going up a whole notch. I want you to have an earthquake plan, and I want you to be prepared just in case you may never have to use the earthquake plan. And I would encourage you also to go watch my forecast